Okay, so last class, what we were looking at was the human genome project at the end. And we looked at what are the basic characteristics where they tried to study all of these 3 × 10⁻⁹ base pairs along with it. And like there were several goals to identify sequence or store or something. And based on that, certain characteristics they were started, right? Or they were studied. And based on whatever was studied, there were certain salient features which were observed, which you can, like which we had studied as well. So now, excuse me. So now, what we are going to start today is the strategy or methodology that has been used to identify those features of the human genome project. So this whole method of human genome project is basically divided into 3 steps, what we call as mapping, sequencing, and the functional analysis. Now, in these 3 steps, first one we will look at, that is mapping. Now, mapping literally means like to prepare a map of something. So in this case, it was specifically of the genetic and physical map of the human genome. That means on which chromosome, first of all, how many chromosomes, on which chromosome, which genes, in which sequence, all of that is included in the mapping process. So the first part of mapping is the identifying molecular markers. Again, this is something like I had given an example yesterday. There are quite a few landmarks. When we travel a distance, there are landmarks. Something like that, there are certain nucleotide sequences which acts as a molecular marker, and they are located only few centimorgans apart from each other, and these were used to prepare the chromosomal map, right? And in which these markers, they are located within a particular chromosome. Not all chromosome will have it at the same distance. So particular nucleotide sequence can be a little closer in chromosome 1 and can be little farther in chromosome 3 or 4 or whatsoever that molecular marker distance is. So that is first step in mapping. Then the second one is the simple sequence repeats. Now the name itself says quite a lot. These are again very short sequences. These are short sequences of the nucleotides, which are also referred to as SSRs, or they are also called as sequence tagged sites. Because a particular sequence is always tagged, that's why it is STS. And they can also be used as genetic markers. Microsatellites, again, even shorter sequences, up to 8 to 10 base pairs, they can act as markers. And all of this mapping was done with the help of PCR amplification process. Now, I am assuming that you may not be aware of this PCR technique. So it is called as polymerase chain reaction. It is a DNA amplification process. Let's say you have only one copy of the DNA and you want to amplify it. That means you want to increase the number of copies of this DNA. That's what when we do this PCR method or the PCR amplification method. Now, usually what is done in the this polymerase chain reaction, you take a DNA sample, you denature it. Denaturation will separate the DNA strand, and then you add nucleotides and DNA polymerase to this separate strand artificially, and that will go on multiplying. So from one copy of DNA, you get 2 copies, from 2, you get 4, and so on. So that way the exponential amplification of single DNA molecule can happen in PCR technique. And there are 3 steps in the PCR, like denaturation, denaturation, elongation, and annealing. Same steps where we are studied in the replication process. So that replication happens just with the means of external method, that is in the laboratory setup. That process is called as PCR amplification. So again, this PCR amplification of a particular microsatellite also provide as a genetic marker. So let's say, like just to give you an example of this PCR amplification, let's say you have found a DNA sample, like especially in case of criminal investigation or in movies, seen that. Like PCR amplification process, you take a particular DNA sample from wherever that site of crime is, you amplify that DNA, and then you match it with which type of characteristic does it match with, and also try to match with the suspects. That means whosoever is might be involved in the crime, trying to match with these suspects, and then the PCR amplification is very helpful technique there. So something similar is also used in the first method of this human genome project, that is mapping. Then the second part of this human genome project was sequencing. Now mapping was done, a particular chromosome with particular genes was identified. The next process was sequencing, that means to identify what nucleotides are present in whole of the chromosome setup or in individual genes. That is like we have seen chromosome 1 was the longest chromosome with almost 2800 amino acid, right? So that is one of the longest. So to identify the gene sequence of all those genes within chromosome 1, that was the next, not just chromosome 1, but all of the other chromosomes. So that part is involved in the sequencing. And this usually involves two approaches, what we call as EST, expressed sequence tagging, and sequence annotation. The difference between these two is here. So expressed sequence tagging, this method involves identifying all the genes that are expressed as RNA. This is not the DNA sequencing. This is specifically RNA sequencing method. And the second method, that is sequence annotation method, that is specifically DNA sequencing method. Now you might wonder, why do we have to do RNA sequencing? Because RNA is the one which makes functional protein, right? Not whole of the DNA makes functional protein. Some of the DNA was part of the non-coding sequence, and that is when this expressed sequence tagging, which is more relevant in terms of protein sequences, and that's what was done. So the process of this expressed sequence tagging we will see here on this slide. So first step is isolation of mRNA from tissue. Again, there are simple buffers in which you break open the cell. Like now there is like cluster of cells, you take it from the petri plate or particular tissue from particular organism. You take those tissue, you digest that tissue, you add certain chemicals which will break open the cell and break open the nucleus so that all the genetic material is out. In this case, the genetic material to be isolated is mRNA, which is in the cytoplasm. So we just need to break open the cell with certain chemicals, usually like EDTA, some Lysol type of, not this Lysol that we use for washing floors. There is a different type of Lysol which is used to lyse the cells, cell membrane specifically. So that is used, so the content goes out, then you separate the proteins and carbohydrate part, what you get in the pellet or the after centrifugation process is mRNA. That mRNA is reverse transcribed to the complementary DNA sequence. Now maybe if you remember, the mRNA sequence had poly-A10 which was added to it later, right? Before it gets transported from nucleus to cytoplasm, that polyadenine tail, which we call as poly-A tail, is added to mRNA. Now, when that is added and when we want to reverse transcribe, that means reverse of transcription process. Transcription is transcription is DNA to mRNA. So reverse transcription will be mRNA to DNA, and using oligo-DT primers. So why oligo-deoxythymine primer? Because this oligo-DT primers, they will go and bind to that poly-A tail, because there will be many AA. So T is complementary to it, that is thymine. So this T will go and bind, and it will start synthesizing the DNA molecule based on that primer using the reverse transcriptase enzyme. So that way we get a complementary DNA copy, which is process of reverse transcription. From there, this generated cDNA, they are separated using gel electrophoresis. Gel electrophoresis was this technique which we had seen earlier, where you run a particular gel on agarose gel. So something like this. This is what we had seen in the last classes. Right. So you add samples in these wells. This is the marker. You add samples, respective ones, and based on their length, they will travel a particular distance. So that way they can be separated. So let's say I know my mRNA length is 3000 base pair. No, this is 1000. So let's say my mRNA length is 1000 base pair. So it will travel along with this distance. And let's say this is the band. So you isolate, you extract this band, cut it out, and then you use it for the further process. That is, so in the next stage, the separated DNA, that is the extracted DNA, will be selected on the basis of size and eluted, that is extracted. And then they are sequenced randomly from both 5' end and the 3' end. That means sequencing. Now, there are quite a few techniques for sequencing, where you identify the sequence of the nucleotide. So there are machines which can be used. Like again, these are highly automated or high throughput machines, where you just put the sample in the what we call as that next generation sequencing, NGS it is called as, next generation sequencing equipments. Then you keep the sample of DNA, mRNA, and it will read the sequence in terms of, it will add certain chemicals, it will check where does it bind. From there, it will identify one by one whole nucleotide sequence, and what you get at the end is the whole of the nucleotide sequence. So the express sequence tags are generated, and their sequences, they are compared using different databases. So at the end, what you get is the final sequence. So that is the method of expressed sequence tag. The main thing that you need to remember in EST is the reverse transcription process. So you isolate the RNA. From RNA, you go back to the complementary DNA. From complementary DNA, you extract it and sequence it, and you get the nucleotide sequence. So that was the one of the method of sequencing in the Human Genome Project. Does anyone have any question here? Are you following or too complicated?
No.
It's easy. Okay. Mansi or Akshay, I hope you are following, because this process is also very critical. Does anyone have any question there? Okay. Fine. Then the next method in the sequences was sequence annotation method. Now, probably you know the meaning of the word annotation. You try to fit whatever sequences they were observed, you try to put them in particular sequence in chromosome. So it involves determining the complete genome sequence, including all, that is coding and non-coding sequences. Like EST was specific to RNA. Sequence annotation method is like includes all of the sequence, coding as well as non-coding. And then assigning functions to the different regions in the sequence. That was done later. So in this case, what was done is total DNA from a cell was isolated. So like I said, you lyse the tissue and then cells and then the nuclear membrane, and they are broken down into smaller fragments by the method of sonication, which uses high frequency sound waves to break the DNA. So cell will also be broken, DNA will also be broken. So first usual step is you break open the cell, you take out the nuclear content separately, and that you use it for the sonication, so that the DNA will be broken into different pieces. Now these broken fragments, they are separated again by gel electrophoresis, that is agarose gel electrophoresis, or it is also called as pulse field gel electrophoresis. phosphoresces because they use a specific electric current. That's why pulse filled gel electrophoresis. Again, you let that gel run and respective fragments. So these segments, they were cloned in the suitable host. So again, you take out. So let's say again, we have done this gel electrophoresis method. We have got so many fragments. Within one sample only, let's say this sample, you can see three. In such cases where we are breaking the DNA, we might get quite a few, more than 10 or so in one sample. That way, we separate respective, we cut out, let's say this we cut out, second we cut out, and third we also cut out, extract the DNA from this gel cut, and then you clone it in certain vectors. Now, vectors are those plasmid-like molecules which are circular-shaped DNA. So, whatever fragment we have extracted, you patch it up or we kind of ligate it with the vector so that we get complete plasmid. So, simplest method to do this is you take a complete circular plasmid and you take extracted DNA. Both of them, you separately add restriction exonucleases which cut the DNA molecule at specific sites. Now, both of these, they will generate a specific sequences which are open-ended. That is the fragment which is extracted from the gel as well as the plasmid vector which is cut. Now, when we will put them together, natural tendency of nucleotide is to form the hydrogen bond, right? So, when we put the fragment and the vector which were cut and we place them together, and because they are cut with the same enzyme, they will have a natural tendency to go and bind to each other. So what ultimately we'll get, and again, this is an enzymatic reaction. We have to add DNA ligase to this reaction sample when we add vector and the fragment together. So what we get at the end is plasmid vector, and which has an insert of the gel electrophoresis fragment. So that way, these segments or these fragments from the gel electrophoresis, they were then cloned into a suitable host using special vectors called as bacterial artificial chromosome or yeast artificial chromosome, that is called as BACs and YACs. And then cloning of these fragments resulted into the amplification of the inserted DNA fragment. So these like vectors along with the fragments, they are put into the E. coli-like bacteria where you multiply the E. coli by just simply growing them into culture medium. So you get many copies of these bacteria. So ultimately, many copies of this vector along with the fragment. Now, because you get amplified or multiple versions of this DNA fragment, these fragments, they are then sequenced using automated DNA sequencers, right? So again, the same method of sequencing is used, like I mentioned of this NGS, next generation sequencing. These kind of high throughput methods are used. So again, you just keep that sample of DNA into that machine. It will read out the sequence by addition of certain radioactive probes or fluorescent probes, and it will read out the sequence based on this binding ability, whether A goes and bind or B goes and bind, and so on. Not A and B, but A goes and bind or T or C or G, whichever goes and bind to that particular nucleotide, it will note it down and it will create a nucleotide sequence. So these sequence contains were arranged on the basis of overlapping regions present in them. So again, the fragments, so there will be multiple copies of the fragments, and these multiple copies can have certain overlapping sequence. So these overlapping sequences, they are tried to match from the chromosome, and from that whole of the sequence is generated. It's like, if I give you sequence like 1 to 15 and then 10 to 25 and then 20 to 35, then you will remove the overlapping regions and then you write numbers from 1 to 35. Right, something of that sort, and each number is each nucleotide. So that kind of analogy is used here, and the whole of the sequence is being generated. So on the basis of overlap, a continuous sequence of nucleotide could be established, like I mentioned, for a particular chromosome region, or it can be done for whole chromosome, or it can also be done for complete genome. Based on all the chromosomal genes, we can generate whole of the sequence. So specialized computer-based programs, they were developed for aligning these base sequences. That is, this overlapping check was done with specialized computer programs, and they were annotated and assigned to each chromosome. Annotated means they were given a particular gene fragment and so on. That is annotation, giving a name to it based on identification. And if you remember, we had seen one of the goal of this Human Genome Project was to develop technology in terms of identifying a particular sequence and then storing that sequence. So that's where the specialized computer programs, they were very helpful. Sequencing of this, and now, so this is the whole process, right? What it was used for Human Genome Project. Now the basic information again. The sequencing of chromosome 1 was completed in May 2006. Like I said, though the project was completed in 2003, there were certain sequences which were not known even till late. So some of them, in the functional aspect and so on, that was still going on. The overlapping inserts in the library were identified. So these overlaps, they were identified by different techniques, what we call as hybridization of short oligonucleotide probe. Oligonucleotide, I hope you remember from the first few slides, these are the nucleotide bases, and these are probed with certain fluorescent molecule or radioactive molecule, and then they are hybridized, and then they are isolated, and then they are checked, okay, what is the sequence. Fingerprinting by restriction mapping. Restriction mapping is using of the restriction endonuclease to cut DNA at certain fragments, and whatever short fragments are we obtain, they, that are used for fingerprinting method. We'll see this DNA fingerprinting at last. And then there is something called as PCR amplification of the short stretches of DNA clone, which we had already seen. So these were the different techniques which were used to create the library, identify the library of those fragments. And the last part out of this mapping and sequencing. So within sequencing, now we have got the sequences in fragments. Some of the sequences, they were complete, but some of the sequences, they were in fragment. So before we go to the functional analysis, the next stage was that generation of the physical and genetic map. So whatever information we had received in terms of sequence, we use those genetic markers where they are present, we use overlapping sequence, we annotated them, and then the whole of the stretch of the chromosome sequence was identified, and then particular physical as well as genetic map was generated. So in that, this was specifically done with respect to the polymorphism of restriction endonuclease recognition site. So let's say we have a long stretch of 1 lakh nucleotide, and within that you just add one restriction endonuclease, that is, let's say EcoR1, which is one example, which cuts at 6 nucleotide bases and it has a specific sequence. I guess it is, let me show you that as well, because that way you will get this clarity. So EcoR1 restriction set. So something like this it cuts, right? So there is EcoR1 enzyme. So let's say this is the whole sequence. So if you add this EcoR1 enzyme, it will cut wherever there is a sequence of GAATTC, it will cut there. And within that 1 lakh nucleotide, this sequence GAATTC can be maybe 100 times, 1000 times, we don't know, right? So it will cut at all those places. So that is what, and the amount of fragments that it will lead to, that will be different, of different nature. And that is what is called as polymorphism. Polymorphism of restriction endonuclease. So within one whole long stretch of DNA, if we add a particular restriction endonuclease enzyme, it will cut the whole longer fragment into smaller fragments, and they can be of different length, and that is what is polymorphism. And some repetitive DNA sequences called microsatellites, they were also used as a markers or genetic markers to generate this physical or genetic marker. Again, any question here in this method of like strategies or methodology of sequence annotation or even express sequence tagging? I hope this part is clear to you all. You need to remember whole process.
How does the fingerprinting?
We'll see that right now. So this is the next one. And I guess that's the last topic. Yeah. So if you have any question, people, Mansi, Akshay, Manskit. Okay, I assume there are no questions. So then, sorry, I missed this point. So applications of Human Genome Project, you can just do it as self-study because there are very few points. What is the use to identify a disease, to identify any genetic mutation, or to study the function of particular gene, overexpression, underexpression, all of this. These, like, what is the function of identifying gene that you can write as application of Human Genome Project? And this you can do it on your own. So the last part is the DNA fingerprinting. Now, DNA fingerprinting is the method of identifying DNAs of different person by locating differences in the arrangement of nucleotide. What does this mean is, though you and I both are human, we have subtle differences in terms of nucleotide sequence. May not be in terms of exons as such. If at all it is mutation in you and you or me, then the exons will be different in terms of that nucleotide change or the mutation. But introns, they are majorly different between individuals. And this goes back to the what we call as thumbprint. Like every individual has a unique thumbprint, or what we call as that arrangement of the fingerprints. So that way, this DNA fingerprinting is the unique DNA sequences that are present in specific individuals. Because ultimately, it's the mixture of mother and father. And your mother and father, they are also they have gotten their DNA sequences from their parents and so on. So that way, it's always very unique sequences to individuals. And to identify those DNA sequences by locating the differences specifically in the arrangement of nucleotides, that is called as DNA fingerprinting. So this was also called as DNA typing or DNA profile. And this was identified by this guy called Alec Jeffrey in 1984. So it is very recent. So, and this is specifically used in identification of suspected criminals. Like I said, wherever we find at this crime site, we find a DNA sample, can be hair, can be blood clot, can be skin cells, can be anything, any part of the body cell, right? That will help in extracting the DNA. That DNA is amplified, that will be sequenced. And obviously we take samples from the suspects and you try to match which sample is matching. So that method is called as DNA fingerprint. How it is done? Again, the same process, isolate the DNA. So you break open the cell, take out as in by the method of centrifugation, you take out the DNA material, amplify the DNA, fragmentation of amplified DNA with restriction endonuclease. Like I gave you an example of EcoR1, you add that EcoR1 or any other restriction endonuclease to the amplified DNA fragments. Then separate the DNA fragments on gel electrophoresis. Again, you let them run. So they will separate based on their sizes. And these separated fragments, they are called as restriction fragment length polymorphism, RFLP, because we have used restriction endonuclease and they have polymorphism of the fragment length. So that's why it is called as restriction fragment length polymorphism. Polymorphism, I already explained, that is same enzyme will cut at different points based on that identified specific site, and it will generate fragments of different length, that is RFLP. Then denaturation of DNA, so that there will be two-stranded DNA, it will be separated into single-strand DNA by alkali treatment, that is just breaking of the hydrogen bond between double DNA helix. And then transfer of the single-stranded DNA fragment from the gel onto the synthetic membrane. So this specific method is called as Southern blotting method. So what you have is, let me show you if at all that is available again. Southern blotting technique, or maybe diagram. Yeah, so I'm not sure which one will be better. Which is the gel? Okay, I assume this one would be better. Yeah. So if you look at this particular diagram, so you take DNA, cut it with restriction enzyme. So what you get is fragments. You let those fragments run on the agarose gel, so they will separate. Now, once they are separated, you make a sandwich of this gel with the paper. Paper is specifically this nitrocellulose paper. So it is like non-transfer. So you use the electricity again to transfer this DNA from gel on the paper. So that is why it needs to be sandwiched. So you can see there is a weight, there is paper towel, something like your tissue papers. Then there is nitrocellulose paper. Below that there is a gel. And below that again there are support structure like again the paper towel and so on. And that you apply the current from this direction. So like negative to positive, so that the gel, the DNA fragments from the gel, they will get transferred to this nitrocellulose paper. So at the end, what you get is nitrocellulose paper with those DNA fragments from the gel. So it is just a kind of transfer method, which is called as blotting method. Blotting means to transfer some material from one membrane to the other one. So that is the Southern blotting method. And the membrane they are specifically used is nitrocellulose, because they are kind of neutral or inert to the DNA fragment. Then the next stage is the fixation of the separated DNA fragments. Now fixation, that means these DNA fragments, they are just on the membrane, right? They can be at the some upper layer of the that nitrocellulose paper also. Some of them can be within the pores. But to fix them there, there is this technique used by exposing the UV light. So that UV light, what it does is, it will fix the particular DNA fragment on the nitrocellulose paper so that it does not move upon washing. And then hybridization. Hybridization is generally used terminology when you add something to a particular material. That is hybridization. So what is being used is, there is this VNTR probes. That is variable number tandem repeats. Name looks very complicated. So these are specific nucleotide sequences which have radioactive material. So VNTR probes, these are radioactive probes. So their nucleotide, one of the atom, they have new radioactive element, and that is used. So what will happen is, depending on the specific sequence, these VNTR probes will go and bind to the single-stranded DNA, which is fixed onto the nitrocellulose membrane, right? So again, nitrocellulose membrane has the DNA fragments which were cut and blotted onto that paper. You add these radioactive probes will go and bind to the DNA fragments on the nitrocellulose paper. So, and then you wash it. So whatever extra radioactive material will be there, apart from the one which has bound to the DNA fragments, that will stay. The rest will be washed. You expose this nitrocellulose membrane to the X-ray. And then what you get is, the hybridized radioactive VNTR will appear as dark band. And the film will provide the DNA profile. So that is the method is called as autoradiogram. This is something like taking X-ray. The last part is something like taking X-ray, but only in X-rays we don't add any radioactive material. It just banks with the X-rays will go and they will be blocked by the bones, and that is what comes on the X-ray film. So something like that, just the opposite way. But so these VNTR probes, they will secrete the radioactivity. So when the X-ray will be bombarding onto them, they will appear as a dark band on a particular X-ray film, and that way a particular DNA can be identified. So based on the intensity of that DNA, intensity of the band, a DNA can be matched with different individuals. So that method is called as DNA fingerprinting. Again, any question, anyone here? So I hope this part is clear. So with this, actually we have finished whole of this chapter, which took really, really long time, but I guess that is fine. So the last thing that I want to show you, and which is actually we should spend more time, is a little playing around with all this. So there are these websites links. So for example, genome database. So you can see it here. So this is the genome database which was identified. Let's say now you want to identify. Now this is additional. This is not related to your syllabus, but this is just a kind of basic general information if you want to play around. So let's say we know human. We want to know a human genome sequence. So let's say I click on human, right? You see the information changes on this side. And then what you get here is the different chromosome sequences. So let's say I want to know X chromosome sequence. So I click on X. It will go to the X chromosome. It might take a little while because people use this database and it's a huge database. So it always takes a little while. So if you see this blue thing, right, that is the sequence of the nucleotide. And these blue lines, if you carefully see, these are usually one of the genes, right? You can see it here also. I hope it will come here. Yeah, you can see some, I hope that part is visible. Yeah, this part. Right, it gives certain information, and it also gives something called as reference sequence, which is linked. So if I click on this, it will give me the whole sequence of that particular fragment, which is shown here as black. And you can also see the location. It is P21.1. So that means on this particular X chromosome at 21 centimorgan and 0.1, there is this particular gene which has a certain sequence. So if at all you want to play around these databases, they are all linked here. There is something called as National Human Genome Research Institute, and which has again quite a lot of database with them. So there are quite a few educational resources, especially in terms of like basic videos and basic information on their website. So you can also go through that. And yeah, you can just explore these five website. This one is also very interesting, which they call it Genome Wave. So if at all you plan to go for research work, these websites, they will be very, very useful for you. Especially the first one, which I have shown you, that genome database, which includes almost all the organisms. I guess here it is. So it actually includes whole of that sequences. So even if you want to check it for zebra fish or chicken or fruit fly or cattle, you can check those sequences in them. Let's say again, for example, fruit fly, that Drosophila melanogaster. There are these many chromosomes which have been identified, and you can also look at their sequences. So same is the case with most of these databases. So that's it from my side. Let me stop here. I'm already overshooting by 3 minutes.